Scratch and Sniff.
Say my name. Heisenberg. You're goddamn right.
Look at you lot, you're all so vacant. Is it nice not being me? It must be so relaxing.
Who are you?
The new number two.
Who is number one?
You are number six.
I am not a number. I am a free man.
Right. Where is it?
Where's what?
The body.
The body?
The corpus delicti. Oh, I'm not particular. Could be stabbed, strangled, riddled with bullets, mutilated beyond recognition.
You're quite right, until we find a body.
We've nothing to investigate.
We're defunct.
Obsolete.
Out of business.
Welcome to Scratch and Sniff, and just a few examples there of the deliciously rich and diverse archive of television programmes past and present from both sides of a pond. But which of these many programmes to watch before our square-eyed carcasses are rolling away to Crimond? Well, general editor and co-writer of 1001 TV series you must watch before you die, Paul Condon, may be able to give us some ideas. And joining me on the line from Salford is Paul himself. Hello, Paul. Welcome to the show. We are so excited about this book, 1001 TV series you must watch before you die. You must. You've got to watch them all.
Well, I think it's more a goal rather than an actual list of everything.
Because I've just been reading your foreword and saying, look, you don't have to take it quite so literally.
No. I mean, if you actually sat down and had to watch every episode of every show in there, I mean, we've got shows like Coronation Street in there.
It would just take, around the corner from you, I think, they filmed that.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, literally, the new set is just over the road from where I live and where I work now, which is lovely.
And, of course, there's an awful lot of Corrie to catch up on if you've never seen it. So, presumably, people should be using it at discretion.
I think it's more of a guideline for people that watch shows on box sets or on Netflix and things like that. And also a history of good TV shows throughout the whole of the TV era, really.
Absolutely.
Going all the way back to the 50s, right the way through to 2015.
Hey, Elsie. Just about ready for the knacker yard.
Sharon. It's been a while.
So you're really covering the full range of entertainment that's out there, past and present.
Well, I think a lot of time when you see people writing about TV, they can be a little bit precious about it. And they can be a little bit, Breaking Bad's the new most important thing of all time. When actually a lot of people really like to watch programmes that are made that are accessible for everyone.
Absolutely.
And so what we try to do is include the one-off brilliant, amazing historical dramas, things like
Home, yeah,
Upstairs, Downstairs, even things like I, Claudius. But similarly, you know, we go into things like I'm a Celebrity. We go into the first proper BBC reality show, which was, well, sorry, British reality show,
The Family,
which was The Family.
Oh, I remember that very well.
Yeah.
Not middle class. I don't consider them any class. I'm just a ordinary person. If I choose to tell everybody my business, that's up to me. If they don't like it, they know what they can do.
And I like to think that once you get your head around the pacing of old television, because it is a little bit slower. Sometimes they take a lot longer to tell stories. I like to think that actually when you go past that, some old TV is just as good, if not better than, the stuff that we have on TV.
I mean,
now.
You're preaching to the converted, Paul, as I think you know. I mean, I sometimes find my partner, who's 10 years younger than me, sort of, you know, what is your problem with this programme? It's dragging on a bit, isn't it? It's a classic Doctor Who's. He does struggle a bit with that, bless his cotton socks. But I obviously don't notice that at all. Paul, what is it about you and television, and in particular the range, of the eclectic range of programmes, both here and abroad over years, that has obviously fired your imagination and sort of led you to write this book?
Well, it's really odd. As a kid, I absolutely loved TV. I was fascinated by it. My actual favourite show as a child was It's a Knockout.
Because I love Mrs. Knockout.
Yeah, I love the spectacle of it and the ridiculousness and people competing and all of that kind of thing.
Can I just tell you something very briefly about It's a Knockout? I have a scar on my hand, and people think it's because I try to slash my wrists or some dramatic thing while listening to a Smith song in the 80s. But I actually got it because of It's a Knockout, because I was jumping over various obstacles that I created in the sitting room at our home, and my mum had French polished the floor because we were leaving the next day, you see, and I put my hand through the French door windows, and I had to be sewn up without any anaesthetic at all.
And what a remarkably lovely red colouring all over the floor for the new owners.
Absolutely. So that was timed very well. Apropos of absolutely nothing, well, it's a knockout. But I mean, I had to tell that story, didn't I? Sorry to divert you back to where you were.
But one of my main interests, apart from that, was I started reading when I was 9, Doctor Who Weekly, which then became Doctor Who Magazine. Mm-hmm. And that was when the magazine was in production back in the day. They started off doing articles about behind the scenes, and that's the way I got really interested in finding out how television programs are made and why they're made. And that was a trigger really for me to find out more, watch more old content, watch more old programs and classics whenever I could get my hands on them. And basically, as a result of that, I've written now, this is my 5th book about TV and film.
Right.
And I've got a career working in TV now. And that's it. Basically just paved the way for me. It's been an obsession with me, really.
Just a minute. You say we've gone back in time?
Yes, quite so.
So that when we go out of that door, we won't be in a junkyard in London, in England, in the year 1963.
That is quite correct. Your tone suggests ridicule.
But it is ridiculous.
It's interesting that you mentioned Doctor Who, because it seems to be an awful lot of people, you know, their careers seem to springboard from TV in general, but Doctor Who is often referenced. Toby Haydock made a point of saying that a lot of people will enjoy Doctor Who and then see beyond it, and it takes them to other places and times, as they say.
Absolutely.
Who else was involved in this?
In this book, my role in it was as general editor, and it was my basic responsibility to come up with the list of 1001 programs.
Wow.
There were quite a few emails going backwards and forwards between the publishers in the UK, the publishers in the USA, and myself pulling hair out at wee small hours of the morning.
Were there any scandalous backhanders from, like, the Castle Waterloo Road, you know, where you're meeting in a dodgy alehouse in Trumpton to discuss this, and packages were being passed?
I'd have been able to have a couple more bottles of champagne this Christmas, but sadly not, no. We were going to include all of the children's programmes in there, but I think we've removed them on the possibility that we may do 1001 kids shows at some point in the future.
I'll write for that one, if you let me.
Yeah, please do, yeah.
Oh, fantastic. I seem to remember we had a little discussion about a programme called Time Slip when we were in the pub one night.
Absolutely.
And I was fighting tooth and nail to get that included, but
sadly not.
Respect.
No.
But there are some children's programmes that have traversed the whole range of 8 to 80.
Yeah, we've kept in the ones that are kind of the ones that young adult audience, or the ones that have, like, for instance, with Tomorrow People, that got remade as an adult drama.
Absolutely.
In America a couple of years ago. So it's equally applicable for the fans of the US show as it is to the original one.
Contact him.
Acknowledge.
What's happening?
It's a technique we have. It increases our perception enormously. I want you to think back, Steve. Think back to last night.
But, essentially, my role as general editor was to come up with that list of the programmes and then find people that I knew could write well about them and were experts on them. Mm. As a result of being a fan of old cult TV and things like this, I've been over to the States many times to conventions. So many of the academics and writers that have written for this are people that I've met at these events over there. Mm. And one of my former work colleagues at ITV is from Copenhagen, so I asked him to write all of the Danish entries for me.
Sure.
So that's all of it. like, well, not so much the killing and the bridge and the ones that are very famous, but all of the other ones for good Danish shows that we probably wouldn't know about. I've really kind of picked the brains of people that I know are experts in the field.
Sure.
People have asked me, what are your favourite television programmes, Paul?
Well,
and I always reply by saying, if you have a look through the book and see which ones I've written, those are my favourite shows because I kept them all for myself.
Scratch and Sniff. With Nick Randall.
Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman. Strange visitor.
So just going through the index, I mean, it's just so eclectic. Things I haven't heard of at all. Still Game, Frontline, Terra Nostra, Freaks and Geeks. And then you've got more familiar entries like Hancock's Half Hour.
BBC Television presents Tony Hancock in
Hancock's Half Hour.
Game of Thrones, of course. One thing I was going to ask you is, that do you think any book like this reflects the time in which it was collated or written? In the sense that you're going to have quite a lot of programmes which are more recent and in terms of sales or anything else. But do you think you've done it as fairly as you can do in 2015?
I think very much so. I think any book like this, and I know from the same company, there is the 1001 Movies You Must See Before You Die.
Mm.
And they actually wait a very long time before they put very recent films in there because there's a consensus about what are the great movies. There have been not many books like this that have ever been written before. Mm. So I don't think there is an international consensus of what great TV is.
Mm.
And yes, I think there is perhaps a waiting towards more recent stuff. More recent stuff you can actually get hold of a lot easier.
Yeah.
And to be honest, we are actually also in a little bit of a golden age for TV. The amount of absolute high quality dramas and series that are being pumped out in vast quantities by networks right across the world at the moment are, full well. You're talking to someone in a pub and they say, "Have you seen this yet?" And you go, "Oh, no, it's on the list.
It's on season, season 8 now." It's like, how am I supposed to do all this? But you're right, there is a glut of it at the moment. I mean, we are spoilt rotten, and I'm sure there'll be a time we'll look back and think, my God, what a fantastic golden age that was. I mean, I think people like us who really get it see it happening now, and it was just good to remind people.
I mean, one of the elements of the book is we've got a little line under each entry that says, for fans of. So we basically, if you like Game of Thrones or if you like a particular kind of show, you could be reading another entry and if it says, oh, for fans of Game of Thrones, that might pique your interest. And I think I, Claudius, is written for fans of Game of Thrones because it's a very similar story. It's about families, backstabbing, manipulation, deaths left, right and centre. But it's done on about 0.25% of the budget of Game of Thrones in a tiny studio in Shepherd's Bush back in 1975.
Didn't forget to celebrate the defeat of my great-grandfather, Mark Antony! How many bottles of wine did you open, toasting his murder while I was doing battle with the sea? Show them our booty! Show them the plunder we gathered from old Neptune!
So that's where I think it's nice to be able to introduce people that are fans of new shows by telling them about old programmes that they may enjoy.
Absolutely, absolutely. And sort of explain to them that it's the older programmes, it's almost like watching a play. And if you try to approach it like that, you probably get so much more out of it.
Well, very much so. It was up until about 1990, television drama was very much shot along the lines of recording a live production.
Yeah.
Around about 1990, it switched to it becoming like a slightly lower budget film. And I find that's the best way to explain to people, if you're watching old telly, that imagine you're sitting watching this in the theatre. And that's when I'm talking to people about two of my particular personal favourite vintage shows, Tenko and Secret Army.
Oh, you're telling me.
That's the way they should approach them, because the amount of quality drama and acting and writing and production in those shows is incredible. But if you approach watching it as if you're watching a stage play, you'll enjoy it a heck of a lot more.
For one short moment when I thought Rosa got away, there was hope for us all. But now, 14 months, 1 week, and 3 days, and where has hope got us? Hmm? Myrtle, gangrene. Mrs. Chang, septic. Something gone wrong. And her, and her, and her, and Debbie, and our Sal, and you were good out when you saw one.
Don't me!
Not when Rose just lies there helpless, a living symbol of the bloody lot of us.
Schoonheim, we have your passenger. Is that how you say, John Staples? Did you know he has a wife and 4 young children in Peterborough, waiting for him to come back? Will you make it impossible?
He is a prisoner of war.
Oh, no, he's a spy. He was dropped by parachutes.
His plane crashed.
The weight of evidence is against you, my friend. He was dressed as a Belgian civilian. He has no military identification and no uniform.
I could say nothing. Either to save him or myself.
Brave words. But you are spent. Nothing awaits you but death.
Well, Herr Major, you don't seem to progress by this interrogation. I shall now take him for Gestapo questioning.
I think it's a fantastic book to be read from cover to cover, or to solve various family arguments, you know, or one could use it to bone up on the latest pub quiz, or to simply dip into it like post-Christmas lunch, you know, when you don't know whether to burp, fart, or retire to the sofa for 40 winks and Mr. Queen or something.
I think it'll be a lovely loo book. You know, I think there's just enough writing for each entry for one little visit to the toilet, I think.
Absolutely.
Well.
So obviously there's going to be loads of great TV over Christmas. How are you planning on watching that, and who with?
Well, I'm spending Christmas with my dad. We're looking forward to it. It's just the two of us now. And so having a very quiet one with just the two of us. Right before then, it's his 80th birthday. So having all the family around.
Well, that sounds lovely.
For that as well.
So. Well, happy birthday and happy Christmas there.
Thank you very much.
Good night, all.
So finally, Paul, in your most perfect sound bites, can you give us 1001 reasons why we should buy this book for Christmas and beyond? No, I'm joking. Give us one good reason.
TV is part of everyone's life, and I think life is too short to watch bad TV. And there's a lot of bad TV around. Yeah. I think if you use this book, it could give you a few pointers as to the kind of shows that you might get a little bit more out of.
That's wonderful. Paul Condon, thank you so much for joining Scratch and Sniff tonight, and happy Christmas.
And the very same to you,
and
too, Nick.
And loads of sales of your fantastic book.
Hurrah!
Dutch girls must be punished for having big boobs. Now, you do not punish someone, Dutch or otherwise, for having big boobs.
If anything, they should be rewarded.
They should be equal.